Macmillan Audio presents Being Lolita, a Memoir by Alisson Wood. Read for you by the author. To my grandmother, who would be so scandalized and so proud. To my mother, who says she will never read this. And to 17-year-old Alisson, who needed this book most of all. A word after a word after a word is power. Margaret Atwood. The first time he kissed me, it wasn't on the mouth. I hadn't read the book yet. He told me it was a beautiful story about love. We would meet in the next town over, a diner off the highway, open all night. I would know what time to meet him in our booth in the back corner because, in the middle of his class, in front of everyone, he would look at me, look into my eyes, and write a number on the blackboard, 8 or 9 or 10, and then wipe it away with his other hand. He was an English teacher in my high school. His shirt sleeves were always chalk-kissed with white. He was 26. The first time he saw me, I was 17. I would tell my parents I was going to a friend's house or studying somewhere, but really, I would be sitting across from him for hours, the pastel painting depicting Greek ruins on the wall above him, while he would grade his students' essays and I would sometimes do my Latin conjugations. Mostly, I would write to him, in front of him, and he would bring it home or sometimes read it there under the 24-hour fluorescence and then write back, all over napkins, the paper placemats, scraps from school. We probably covered hundreds of pieces with cursive, but I have only the handful that I hid from him, kept close and stolen away. Before we would leave, he'd take the papers and napkins and rip them up, put them into our water glasses, and I would watch them lose their shape and the ink bleed. I wasn't allowed to keep things. I wasn't supposed to call him Mr. when we were alone, only his first name. But I could never call him that in school. No phone calls, no emails, no touching. He made the rules. The rules were broken at that diner in our booth. It was May. Summer was almost there, and graduation hung in every classroom, crepe paper and glue glitter banners filling the halls, a countdown everywhere. You couldn't escape it. He was trying to teach me about great literature, to prepare me for what I would face as a freshman in college just a few months in the future. "You should definitely be an English major," he told me, leaning back into the booth, his arms stretched out on top of the bench, taking up so much space across from me. It was the pose that, if we were on a date, unseen in a dark theater, would be the transition movement before he put his arm around me. He wouldn't bother with a fake cough. He'd just go for it. I was sure. He would read me the greats at our table of beige formica and dull silver. Poe, Dickens, Hawthorne, Carroll. He'd get into it, doing voices when he read Alice's Adventures in Wonderland, laughing at literary jokes that I was surely supposed to understand, so I laughed too. I lapped it up, knowing how lucky I was to have this kind of private instruction. That night, he was reading Lolita to me, from the beginning of things. He spoke to me in Nabokov's opening lines languidly, "Light of my life, fire of my loins." I thought it was the most romantic thing ever. But I was ruining it. I had a bug bite and I kept pushing my ankles together, trying to quell the tinge of itch, a child who couldn't sit still. He began rubbing the edges of the pages with his thumb, harder and harder as his voice grew louder, creating tiny rips in the paper as he stroked them. Finally, he asked, "A mosquito bite?" "Yes," I said, an invisible ruler against my spine. "Don't you have any calamine lotion?" "Not on me," I said. "You know," he said, "saliva can stop the itch." He looked at me. He had green eyes. My flip-flopped feet were on the cracked red leather next to him on the booth, my legs under the table, bridging the gap between our benches. Not touching, just beside him. I followed the rules. He leaned down to my foot next to him and put his lips on my pink, swollen ankle. I felt his breath on my skin. And it was like every locker in the halls of my high school swung open at once, metal kissing cinderblock walls. It felt just like that. Part 1. Nymph. 1. I thought she died, someone whispered. I didn't know who said it, but I knew they meant me. I remember the halls of my high school the first day of my senior year. I remember lockers that were green like the flu and taupe, a feeling of illness. I heard she was committed to a mental hospital. That's where she was last year. Have you seen the scars on her arms? I remember I woke up early that morning, startled that the day had arrived, changing my clothes over and over. My mother tried to braid my hair, but it wasn't perfect, so I took it out. She flunked out. I remember I didn't realize I hadn't brushed my teeth until after I was already in the main office getting my locker combination. She's such a slut. I remember walking alone. There is a long history of loneliness in literature. Of loneliness as a prerequisite to love. Almost like you can't really love someone unless you've been alone and loveless for a long time. At least if you're a woman. Almost as if this protracted alone time is a purification, prepares a girl to be worthy of a man's love. Think of the Greek myths, the Odyssey, Calypso dancing sorcery alone on her island, Penelope waiting 20 years for her wandering husband to return. Think of our fairy tales, the stories we tell our daughters before we put them into bed, of Cinderella toiling in the dust before she can be fitted for those slippers, of Rapunzel living in a tower with only her long hair as silent company. And then her prince comes to rescue her. Nabokov said that all good stories are fairy tales. At 17, I was primed to be someone's princess. 2. It started on purpose. Mid-September, I was taking a creative writing class alongside English, theater, studio art, social studies, math, and Latin. I hated algebra. I loved Latin. I loved writing most of all. My creative writing teacher, Miss Croy, was new. She didn't know anything about me, only vague notes from the school's social worker. In class, she gave me blank pages to fill however I wanted. She wrote comments with purple ink in my black and white modeled composition book, things like, "lovely image," or "so clear," or "wow," with so many exclamation points. At 17, I filled journals like running water. That Monday, in my notebook at the end of my assignment, in her cursive writing on blue lines, she added, "Come to my room after school today to talk?" The question filled me with fears. Did she find out about my past? Did she talk to someone? Does she now think I'm crazy too? I spent the rest of the day with a hollow chest, a stomach of crawling insects. I opened the door to her classroom, certain I was in trouble, that I was again a disappointment to some adult. She wasn't alone. Due to overcrowding, the new teachers had to share their classrooms, and I recognized the man next to her, another new, young English teacher. I must have seen him before in the halls. Miss Croy waved me in front of them, the big wooden desk between us. The other teacher was tall with broad shoulders leaning against the desk. "This is the young woman I was telling you about. This is Alisson," she told him. "Alisson, this is Mr. North." "Right. Him." When you don't talk much, you hear everything. The other girls thought he was so hot. His dark hair was long enough to stay behind his ears, but still short enough to be appropriate for a grown-up. He had a full shadow of beard, something only a handful of senior guys could manage, and flouted the requirement about teachers wearing ties. I noticed his shirt had a tiny moose embroidered on the side of the pocket. He shopped at Abercrombie & Fitch just like the students did. The mixed signals of adult man and teenage boy in his body radiated through the air, making everything thick and quiet and warm. His eyes fixed on mine, and I felt stunned, an animal across a meadow. My breath caught and ribs knit. He was a concoction of the accessible and forbidden, the perfect teenage lollipop. Mr. North offered his hand. I blinked and breathed and shook his hand strong like my mother taught me. When our palms pressed against each other, it was like an electric current was made complete, everything suddenly alive in me. "Hey," he commented, surprised or impressed, or at least pretending to be, by my handshake. My face was still full of questions. Miss Croy continued to him, "Alisson is a gifted writer, and I thought she could use some extra attention outside of my class." I felt my skin go hot. And then to me, "Mr. North is a writer too. He's agreed to start meeting with you after school." The teacher started on about his background, Columbia, Cornell, and how we could meet here tomorrow after school. Just bring a new journal just for us. He kept smiling at me. But I kept spinning Miss Croy's words inside my head. She called me gifted. She thought I was good. Good enough to deserve something. Mr. North was a gift. I saw myself looking at Mr. North as he looked at me, that slow motion feeling blooming in my body. Mr. North put his hand on my shoulder. Would I come see him tomorrow? He wanted to see me. I heard my voice leave my body. Yes. 3. The thing about princesses is that they're not usually very active in their own lives. Things happen to a princess, and all she has to do is say yes. Sometimes she doesn't even have to speak. Her prince will just appear, ready for action. He knows what she needs, maybe even more than she does. Passive princesses abound in fairy tales. They are always falling into danger and the path of some man who has to take the trouble to save them. Sleeping Beauty is the most obvious example, a beautiful girl who is trapped in slumber and needs her true love's kiss to awaken. And we cannot forget the Disney classic, Snow White and the Seven Dwarves, where yet another princess is saved from the sleep of death by the mouth of her prince. I had my own troubles with sleep. My insomnia was sneaky. Sometimes it would happen like this. I would be reading and just keep reading. I would start a new painting using watercolor and nail polish on canvas I bought at the craft store where I worked on the weekends. Or I would have started cutting something out of a magazine, 17 or Sassy, with some specific idea for another collage, and keep cutting and rearranging and smearing purple glue stick and watch it turn clear on the poster board, and then I would hear birdsong. Those nights happened by accident. The worst nights, though, I would be in bed the whole time, in the darkness, and just be awake. My room was small. My twin bed, my grandfather's wooden writing desk, my own phone and answering machine, a bookcase overcome with books. I covered the walls with words and images I cut out. There was a coughing radiator, painted lavender, in the corner. I had an alarm clock that did little. Sometimes my mother would call me after she got to work, around 9 or 10 in the morning, to see if I was up yet, repeating my name on my answering machine until I picked up the phone. "Allie, Allie, it's your mommy." A strange song that would infiltrate the last of my dreams. Most days I would wake up to an empty house. So it was at the beginning of senior year, I was almost always late to school. The doors automatically locked after the final homeroom bell rang. From then on, you had to get buzzed in by the ladies in the front and get a hall pass to go to whatever class you were late to. Most days, I was not in homeroom at 7:20 a.m. for my homeroom teacher to mark me as present. It took only a few weeks for the women in the office to start rolling their eyes at me when I'd ask for a pen to sign the clipboard, even if I was only a few minutes late, especially if I walked in closer to lunch. By this point, it seemed as if everyone had given up on me. I had exhausted my parents' disapproval and emotional investment that had no heartwarming return, and the only thing left was a sort of resignation to my situation. I would get myself to school, or I wouldn't. I was 17 now. It was my problem. It's not like I needed a ride anymore.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.